Gracias.
Okay, thank you, Eric. Hello and welcome, everyone. My name is Guillermo García. I'm a PhD student from the Technical University of Madrid, and I'm going to talk about OSLC in the context of DevOps, particularly in scenarios where there is event-based automation. So I'll start by giving you some context about my work. I'll make an introduction to DevOps in general, presenting three challenges and their potential solutions. These challenges are integrating automation as a service and standardizing event-based automation. Finally, I'll explain a case study I developed as an example that faces all of these challenges. So for the past months, I've been working on a project which seeks to enhance DevOps environments using semantic technologies. We focus particularly on automation based event based on events, rules, and actions. Since we came across OSLC, I've been studying the specifications to see how it can help in achieving our goals. So before going any further, we need to talk about what we understand by DevOps, because this concept has been given many definitions. So we need to establish some common ground. This definition is, in my opinion, a good one. A collaborative and multidisciplinary effort within an organization to automate continuous delivery of new software versions while guaranteeing their correctness and reliability. Oversimplifying things a bit, for us, the main goal of DevOps is to accelerate the production, testing, and delivery of applications. So for this purpose, a good DevOps infrastructure for us would need to have the following features. First, it needs to be scalable. This is achieved using a microservices architecture where different functionalities are separated into their own services and exposed through APIs. Second, the infrastructure must be capable of adapting to fast changes in the market. This means being able to rapidly integrate new services into the infrastructure. Finally, a good DevOps environment needs to have automated tasks such as building, testing, and deployment of applications. Automating these processes is known as continuous delivery. However, when these three features are implemented in a real infrastructure at the same time, we are presented with three different challenges. Challenge one is faced when trying to build a microservices architecture that also supports fast service integration. This is the challenge of integrating DevOps services. So what happens in a microservices architecture is that there are many services involved, and each of them has its own different API. This makes migrations expensive because interfaces between services have to be rewritten for them to work together. This is known as a problem called vendor locking, and it is incompatible with the flexibility and versatility that our adaptability feature requires. Currently, migrations are often done manually, which is very slow and expensive in terms of time and money. Services could use standard APIs to make it a seamless process, but they usually don't because it is hard to come up with a standard that covers the needs for every tool, and also because it could limit the possibilities that developers have of innovating and designing original features. A potential solution to this channel, of course, could be OSLC. OSLC allows for seamless integration between tools that are compliant with its specifications. Because it makes no assumptions about the internal structure of the tools that it is modeling, it only focuses on the properties relevant for interoperability, not interfering with other possible features a developer might want to implement in his or her tool. Such flexibility is possible thanks to its linked database models. OSLC solves the integration challenge, okay. But what about automation in a microservices architecture? Well, challenge two arises when we identify automation as a feature that, following our DevOps philosophy, should be separated into its own independent service. This concept is known as automation as a service, and the tools that implement it are called task automation service. A task automation server, or TAS, is a tool that provides automation capabilities for other services. They are based on the ECA model, which stands for event, condition, and action. Following this model, a TAS would receive a notification when an event is triggered in another service. Then a set of conditions or rules would be evaluated and actions are sent for execution according to these rules. So there are many commercial examples of task automation servers in the world of users applications, like IFTTT, Zapier, or Automated. You might have heard about them. In the DevOps field, the most relevant TAS right now is TaxStorm. Besides the services that it supports natively, TaxStorm has a marketplace where developers upload their integrations with other services, and the catalog is quite extensive. However, with task automation servers like TaxStorm, we are facing the vendor locking problem again. The infrastructure becomes dependent on the TAS that we are using because all of the automated tasks that we have defined are only available for that particular TAS. If a new TAS was released and we wanted to incorporate it into the infrastructure, we would have to rewrite all of the automated tasks so they work in this new TAS. A potential solution to this problem would be to define a semantic model for task automation servers. This would enable rule interoperability between them, so the automations built for one TAS could work in all of them. There is an ontology named EWI which defines such a semantic model. The EWI ontology can enhance a task automation server with the flexibility of a linked data model and the reasoning capabilities of semantic rule entries. The main concepts in EWI are channels, which define interfaces with other services, as well as the events and actions that are available for that interface. And on the other hand, rules, which are evaluated every time an event is triggered to decide which action needs to be executed. An implementation of a TAS that is based on EWI semantic model is EWI Tasker. It uses the iReasoner to evaluate its rules. So we have an implementation of a TAS that supports semantic rules. Okay, we have only one more challenge left to face, and that is how to make fast integrations in an event-based automation environment. Now that we have standardized the service interfaces with OSLC and the way we define rules in our TAS with EWI, we need a link between both worlds. We need to find a way to seamlessly integrate any interface, any service with our TAS, so our DevOps environment doesn't lose its adaptability feature. OSLC defines the OSLC automation spec to build interfaces for services like our TAS, and it could be the answer to this final channel. The specification, however, will need to be extended to cover all of the necessary aspects for a TAS. The goal with OSLC automation is to build an OSLC interface for the TAS itself so it can be integrated in the infrastructure like any other OSLC service. Right now, OSLC automation itself doesn't support events and actions. However, OSLC does provide some features that can be used for modeling them. For events, we can use OSLC Track Resource Sets Protocol, or TRS. TRS exposes a log with changes suffered by the resources. So any creation, modification, or deletion of a resource can be detected by a consumer. With the new version 3 of TRS, more complex events could be supported using TRS patches. A new specification could also be defined to cover more aspects about automation events that are missing in OSLC. Regarding actions, there are three basic actions that can be executed on most OSLC resources. These are creating, updating, and deleting the resource. This is known as the CRUD model, and there are HTTP methods to dispatch each of them. There is also OSLC actions, which is now inactive, but is a candidate for a specification, which might be worth reactivating. Having events and actions defined in OSLC, it is possible to think of an architecture where a TAS has a service in front of it exposing its automation capabilities using OSLC automation. An OSLC service would work as a source of event for this automation server. Once the event is processed by the TAS, the rules it has stored are evaluated to find the corresponding actions to be executed. The return actions will be executed in another OSLC service, completing the integration of the automation provider with the rest of the infrastructure through OSLC. And now to end the presentation, I'll explain a case study where all of these ideas are put into practice in a more realistic environment. Okay, so let's say that there are two teams working on the same project. One is the development team that uses GitHub issues to track the changes suggested for the application. The other one is the testing team, and they use a different tool for this same purpose, which would be Vaxilla. So we want to be able to replicate the bugs from Vaxilla as is using GitHub and vice versa automatically. This, of course, could be done by manually by writing a program that communicates with both APIs and connects them together. However, we might have a new team in the future that uses GitLab or any other tool, and we would have to rewrite the same program again for this new services API. Therefore, we choose to use OSLC interfaces, so any of these services that complies with the specification, of course, can be easily integrated as well. Not only that, but we also might want to take the automation further. This is just a simple example where we are mirroring one service in another, but we could, for example, have a continuous delivery pipeline with automated tests and automated deployments. And we could want to execute that pipeline when a bug is closed or an issue is closed. So to support all these more complex automations, we would need a task automation server. And we wanted to support semantic rules, of course, for interoperability. So the first thing we need to do is to build the OSLC interfaces for our services. Vaxilla already has one available for the OSLC tutorial, where products are the service providers and bugs are the resources, the OSLC resources. For GitHub, we defined it in a similar way, taking repositories as service providers and the issues as OSLC resources. And the domain is the same as in Vaxilla, which is change management. So the scenario would work like this. When a bug is created, the OSLC interface in front of Vaxilla exposes it as an HTTP resource, as OSLC always does. Then an event is sent to the task automation server to notify the event. In this case, we use TRS to expose the change as a change event. And here, in reality, this event doesn't go directly from the TRS server to the task automation server, but there is an intermediate software calling the TRS server and sending the event to the task automation server. And this is one of the reasons why we would be interested in expanding the OSLC automation specification. So this intermediate software is not necessary and events can be directly sent to the task automation server. So once the event goes into the task automation server, in this case, if we task it, it does its thing, it evaluates its rules, and according to these rules that are evaluated, it sends an action. And In this case, the action is an HTTP post request with the corresponding OSSC resource that it wants to create. Again, here we used an intermediate software that took the action and translated it into a post request, but this could be avoided using OSSC actions. So it would be interesting to reactivate that specification. And finally, what a GitHub issue is created from the adapter, completing the whole automated process. So to conclude, we will see how the scenario contains our desired features for a DevOps environment. So it supported a microservices architecture, checked, as different functionalities were separated into independent services. New services could be integrated fast as long as they use standard interfaces, OSSC interfaces. We could integrate them easily. And it provided automation features through a task automation server with semantic capabilities. So as future work, we would like to make extensions to OSSC automation so it can cover more of the relevant aspects found in a task automation server. And having a model for events in OSSC could be also very beneficial, either inside of the OSSC automation specification or in its own separate one. And the text of OSSC actions looks very promising for this application, so it might be worth reactivating that candidate for specification as well. So thank you very much. I think I had some minutes left, but
let's see. Oh, thank you very much. Yeah,